Good afternoon and welcome. Most of all, congratulations to all of you here who passed the California bar this year. My name is Erwin Chemerinsky. I have the tremendous privilege and pleasure of being the Dean of Berkeley Law. And we are here to celebrate those who passed the bar and to swear them in to the California bar and the bar of the United States District Court of the Northern California. And so I want to begin by asking all of our LLM graduates who are here, who passed the bar and are being sworn in, to please rise so we can recognize you. And if I could ask all of our JD graduates who are being sworn into the bar today to please rise so we can recognize you. Before we get to the business of swearing you in to the California Bar of the Northern District, I would just offer a few thoughts for you. First, and maybe most important, take this time to celebrate your accomplishment. This is the culmination of so many years of school, of course, 3 years of law school, of studying for the bar, of hours that can't be calculated, of hard work. And this is truly a day to celebrate, and I think this is a milestone that you should recognize and certainly take the time to celebrate. Second, I hope that each of you will use your law license to make a difference. To make a difference in your community, in our society, the world. With your law license, you really can make a difference. All of us at times hear people say, somebody should do something about that. Now you are the ones who can do something about that. And finally, I would simply say to you, always remember that your law license is a privilege, it's not a right. You worked so hard to get it, never do anything that would put it in jeopardy. And I hope as you go forward in your careers, you won't be strangers to Berkeley Law. I hope you'll be involved in our alumni association, in our programs, and in so many ways. But you're not here today to hear from me. You're here to hear from very distinguished people who will move your admission to the bar and swear you in. I'm going to do just very brief biographies of them and apologize, because otherwise we're spending all our time to hear from them. The person who will move your admission to the bar is the president of our alumni association, Cara Sandberg, from the class of 2012. Deputy County Counsel for the County of Santa Clara. She's a member of the Social Justice and Impact Litigation Team. She'd been an attorney for Justice Tino Cuellar on the California Supreme Court, clerked on the United States Court of Appeals for the First Circuit, as well as the Northern District of California. As I said, she will move your admission into the California Bar, but then to speak to you and swear you into the California Bar is Justice John Streeter, member of the class of 1981. He's an Associate Justice of the California Court of Appeal. After graduation, he clerked for Judge Harry Edwards on the United States Court of Appeals for the District Columbia Circuit. He had a very distinguished career as a lawyer at Orrick, Harrington, Sutcliffe, and Kecker and Van Nest. And he's a fellow of the American College of Trial Lawyers and a former president of the State Bar of California. And then once you've been sworn into the California Bar, you're then eligible to be sworn into the bar of the United States District Court for the Northern District of California. And to speak to you and to swear you into that bar is Judge Trina Thompson, who's a member of the class of 1986, and she is a judge on the United States District Court for the Northern District of California. Like the other two speakers you'll hear from, she's a Berkeley Law graduate. In fact, she's a double bear, a phrase I learned in coming here. And she had a very distinguished career, first in practice, and then for many years as a judge on the Superior Court. And I have to confess to you, we didn't randomly choose these three people to come speak to you today to move your admission and swear you in. As I think of the many graduates of this law school, I cannot think of three individuals who are better role models for you in your career, of how to use law to make a difference, and how to practice law with the highest ethical standards. With that, I'll turn it over to the president of our Alumni Association, Cara Sandberg.
Good afternoon. Anything? Good afternoon. It's so wonderful to be here with you all celebrating the accomplishments of our recent graduates. My name is Cara Sandberg. I'm the current president of the Berkeley Law Alumni Association and a proud graduate from the class of 2012. I'd like for everyone to just take a moment to look at the other graduates that are here beside you. Take a second, look next to you, look behind you, make eye contact with each other. So it's my privilege to welcome all of you as our newest members of this robust and dedicated alumni community. This is a community I know will sustain and support you, not only at times of joy and celebration like today, but whenever you find yourself in a position where you may need encouragement or assistance. When I think about why I remain dedicated to the Berkeley Law community, I think on a few things that I know will resonate with our recent graduates. I think about my mentors. These include students that graduated in the years before me. They also include alumni mentors who have guided me during periods of challenge and periods of change. I also think about the incredible financial support that I received when I was a student working as a research assistant and as a summer law clerk. The amazing opportunities that you all enjoyed as Berkeley Law students are possible only because of the donations and what I like to call the culture of gratitude, the culture of giving that we all engage in as alumni members. I look forward to having all of you join us in that culture and to be able to contribute back to current students so that they might have the same sorts of wonderful opportunities that you all enjoyed. I also think about the friendships and relationships that I cultivated, not just in law school, but also after graduation. So you all are at a very exciting point in your careers. The friendships that you formed, probably with folks that are sitting beside you today, those will continue to grow, just as you will as young lawyers. And you will certainly have the opportunity to connect with other alumni, folks that graduated 4, 10, 25 years before you. You'll make these new professional connections and these personal relationships. In my experience, Berkeley Law alumni are always thrilled to meet another golden bear, and you can count on that in our alumni community. As a new alum, I know that you're really excited about having the opportunity to sign on to the state bar website, update all of your information, contact info, get your bar card in the mail. I'd like you to also, as you're thinking about those logistics, take a moment to update your contact information for us here at the law school. One of the ways that we're able to stay in touch with you and invite you to wonderful programs is by having your most recent contact information. We also use that information as a way to invite you to come back to campus and to connect with us. I'd love to see our most recent graduates back here on campus, serving in any capacity that suits you, whether that's as a mentor to a current student or an incoming 1L, as a panelist for a law school class, or as an alumni volunteer. One of the things I love most about the Alumni Association is that we strive to create those sorts of opportunities for alumni to engage with the law school and with current students. We truly rely on the excitement and the dedication of our alumni, especially our most recent graduates, all of you. It is incredible that you have made this accomplishment. I know that so many of you have your friends and family, your community members that supported you while you were studying here beside you today. I'd like us all just to take a moment to show our appreciation for the support that you have received during your studies and as you made this huge accomplishment. Let's give everyone a hand. Your strength as young lawyers is certainly going to be informed by the care and the love that you've received from your families, from your friends, and from your communities. And it's so wonderful to have many of you here to celebrate with us today. So it's now my pleasure to introduce the Honorable John B. Streeter, Class of 81, Associate Justice of the California Court of Appeal, First District. Justice Streeter, I move for admission to the State Bar of California, these graduates of Berkeley Law who have passed the state bar exam.
The motion having been made, I'm going to take it under submission and speak to you for a moment or two before I rule on it. You're going to hear some of the same themes from all of us here. You know, being in the law, it's been such a great privilege for me. I know my colleagues here would share this, but it's a little bit like a relay race in that one always looks to the examples of those who have gone before us. Some 42 years ago, I took the oath of membership to the State Bar of California. The event was particularly memorable for me because the judge who administered the oath, a graduate of this great school, who would go on to become an icon of the federal bench, was Judge Felton Henderson. He embodied the values I most prized in the law, dedication to the principles of equality and justice. So I know that the event and the who doing the swearing in matter. Please listen carefully to each one of us as we touch on some very important themes for you. For me, like you, law school was, you know, I can't say it was easy. Worked hard, but I'm one of those people who enjoyed every minute of it. Now, I didn't have the same kind of experience or anything near to what you had, starting law school online. I can't even imagine the difficulty of transitioning into the law by video, because this is a profession that really requires personal interaction. But once we got here, and eventually you did, in person, we all entered this place under that densely written Cardozo inscription on the far western wall of the building, where it is loftily said, "You will study the precepts of justice, for those are the truth. Through you shall come the hour of triumph." In those words, to everyone convening, all the students at this school, Justice Cardozo points to the splendid possibility of achievement and said, "I summon you and bid you welcome." When I arrived to those words, I discovered that the reality was a little bit grittier and that the promise of achievement held out in Cardozo's inscription would often be hard to come by in a class that was handpicked for its blazing talent, just as yours is. And let me underscore what my colleague has said about the importance of your peers here. I came away from law school feeling that I had learned just about as much, maybe more, from my peers than I did from those who were teaching my classes. Those who are sitting beside you will include lifelong friends, and you will watch as each of you does amazing things in the law over the years. It took some years for me to appreciate the gift of dispassionate, critical analysis and the grounding in legal reasoning that my law school training gave me. Every graduate, I think, emerges from this place with a set of tools that will be put to use in ways that you cannot yet imagine. And here, let me touch on what Dean Chemerinsky said. I urge you, too, to be bold about what you do with those tools. You now have the capacity to have great impact on the lives of others. Make the most of it in whatever way is fitted to your particular vision. Now, your responsibilities as a member of the bar will be great. Much is packed into the oath you are about to take. always remember that those who are true and faithful to their oath collectively earn public esteem, and those who lose their way can do much to damage the reputation of the profession as a whole and public trust in the justice system, which is the lifeblood that every judicial officer will tell you runs through our system. You are officers of the court. Now, some of you should consider, as you enter this great profession, all of you should consider, it is not just a matter of duty to look at your responsibilities as an officer of the court as a matter of duty. It's also a matter of aspiration. I'll make a couple of quick observations about those aspirational qualities, and then I'll give you some concrete advice. I encourage those of you who are willing to do it, for example, to carve out some time in your busy law practices to represent those who are indigent and without counsel. You enter the bar at a time that reminds all of us every day of our duties as citizens. There has been no greater challenge facing a generation in the law as those that challenge your generation. I know you can live up to them. The oath you are about to take, the same one taken by all of us who went before you, is not just an incantation of words. Pay close attention to the meaning of the words, and in particular, I ask you to reflect upon and take with utmost seriousness the last line of your California oath, which calls upon you as an officer of the court to strive to conduct yourself at all times with utmost dignity, courtesy, and integrity. Even in the midst of the most fraught, difficult, and emotion-laden debates on the most high-stakes issues of the day, I guarantee you that the leading voices in those debates will always abide by this canon of conduct. It is more than a matter of civility or politeness. For those who master it, it is a matter of discipline that will drive your effectiveness and enhance your credibility as an advocate and counselor. Now, turning to the practical, I have a list of 10 concrete pieces of advice I'd like to give you. First, give your word and always keep it. Second, accept responsibility and then perform. Third, pay attention to detail, but keep the whole picture in mind. Fourth, remember that exploiting short-term advantage often brings bad consequences. Fifth, of course, be truthful, but also take the trouble to be accurate. Being candid requires courage and tact. Sixth, understand that courtesy and graciousness are usually repaid in kind. Seventh, never ever forget that your integrity is your greatest and most precious asset. Eight, be an attentive listener. Nine, avoid criticism that is either needless or non-constructive, or both. Tenth, and finally, remember that whether you realize it or not, you are now a teacher, a mentor, a role model, an ambassador at large for the bar and the justice system. That brings with it responsibilities, so conduct yourself accordingly. That is my charge to you. And at this point, I will ask you to please stand and repeat after me as I administer the licensing oath for the State Bar of California. Raise your right hand, please. I solemnly swear or affirm that I will support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California. And I Okay, let's begin again. I can't grant the motion unless you've taken the oath. I solemnly swear or affirm that I will support the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California. And that I will faithfully discharge the duties of an attorney and counselor at law. To the best of my knowledge and ability. As an officer of the court, I will strive to conduct myself at all times with courtesy, dignity, and integrity. Congratulations, the motion is granted, and you are now ready to begin the serious work of lawyering.
Congratulations. How does it feel? It feels good. But there's more. So we'll next move for your admission to the federal bench. So I, Cara Sandberg, as a member of the Northern District of California, hereby move for admission of the newly admitted members of the State of California to practice before the United States District Court in the Northern District of California, pursuant to Civil Local Rule 11-1 and 11-4. Here to administer the oath is the Honorable Trina Thompson, Class of 86, District Judge of the United States District Court for the Northern District of California.
Good evening. This is such a pleasure and a joy for me. I will not be telling you how many years it's been since I left law school. I will let you do the math, 1986. But ladies and gentlemen, parents, I am just thrilled to see these parents in the audience because a lot of your young adults don't know the anguish, the tears, the sucking of the teeth, the one-word responses that you've had to endure until they've made it to this point. And I hope that each of you, as you move forward in your careers, you will look back on those adults who were important to you, who actually helped usher you through this. It's a blessing to have parents with you. I myself had the blessing of two sets of parents. I was a foster child, so I had foster parents that also are still with me even to this day and applauded me through all of these transitions. The consistent adults in your life are more important than you'll ever know as you go through all of these different changes throughout your life. Distinguished guests, and most importantly, our soon to be newly sworn federal court counsel. There are things that I want to share with you. I've now experienced my 1.5 year as a federal judge. I just left a huge dinner at the Supreme Court and met a number of my class to come in as federal judges. Before that, I served 20 years as a state court judge. Obviously, I just like punishment. But as I walked into the halls of the federal court in San Francisco, I was still shocked to learn that I would be the only one that looked like me in that building sitting as a jurist. I was surprised when I hired my law clerks who were second year lawyers who came in with great trepidation and fear about whether they fit in, whether they were going to be accepted, and whether they were smart enough. And I shared with them, if I hired you, you are more than smart enough. But not only are you smart enough, I hired you because you have resilience. I hired you because you have tenacity. I hired you because you have everything that you needed when you first arrived at your law school. And then, if you came from Berkeley Law, well, it's enough said. So today marks a significant milestone in your journey. As you embark on your legal careers, I stand before you to emphasize the values that will guide you towards becoming exceptional advocates of justice, integrity, civility, inclusion, all of which are the pillars upon which we must build our legal profession, not only to uphold the law, but also to uphold humanity. This is a very interesting time in our lives, and we're about to hand the baton to you to do what needs to be done next. When I share with you, the first and foremost is integrity. In a world where ethical boundaries are often blurred, your commitment to unwavering integrity will be the compass that guides you and guides every decision you will make. Remember that the law is not just a set of rules, but a reflection of our shared values. Upholding the highest standards of honesty, transparency, and moral courage. The last is the most difficult to do because we often want to be liked, we want to be included, we want people to affirm us by just saying, go along to get along. But having moral courage takes more than that. I had the pleasure of being friends with Karen Korematsu, Fred Korematsu's daughter. And whenever we part company, she says to me, don't be afraid to speak up. If you loved my dad's legacy, you will never be afraid to speak up. There are so many people in this community that are waiting for you to arrive. And they want you to earn the trust of your clients, your colleagues, and the community. Let integrity be the hallmark of your practice, and let it serve as a beacon of hope for those who seek justice. Civility, my friends, is the bridge that connects us all. As lawyers, you will inevitably find yourself in adversarial situations, advocating passionately for your client's interests, but never forget that behind every opposing counsel, there is a fellow human being. Treat them with respect, even in the heat of battle. Engage in rigorous debate, but do so with grace and dignity. Remember that your words hold immense power, and the way you choose to use them can either build bridges or burn them down. Choose civility and let it be a catalyst for constructive dialogue, compromise, and ultimately resolution. If you don't remember anything I say to you today, remember the three things that I tell my clerks when they want to get snarky is it kind, is it true, and is it necessary? And if you can say yes to all three of those questions, you can include that in my draft order. That'll probably get redlined, but you can include it. Inclusion is not just a buzzword. It is the fundamental principle that should guide our profession. The law is meant to serve all people, regardless of race, gender, religion, socioeconomic status, or background. As lawyers, it's your responsibility to ensure access to justice for everyone. Embrace diversity in all forms, for it enriches our perspective, it broadens our horizons, and it makes us better advocates. Seek out opportunities to champion the rights of marginalized communities, to amplify voices that have been silent, and to dismantle the barriers that perpetuate inequality. Let inclusion be the driving force behind your pursuit of justice, and let it inspire you to inspire others to do the same. I cannot tell you what it feels like to come in rooms and be in total isolation, and not know whether there will be anyone to be a mentor, to assist you. And I can always say that Berkeley Law provided me with that. My best friends followed me to Washington, D.C. during my confirmation hearing, Tracy Tabor, Dwayne Lyons. At my induction, Marvin Campbell, Hamida Little, at my baby judge school, yeah, we go to baby judge school, go figure, Fernando Rocha. All of us were in the same class, and we're now each other's support system, and we have not stopped. And now, even with my best friend, my daughter and her daughter are roommates. We call them Pete and Repeat. Who knew? And when we came to this law school, we were very different women. We didn't share any of the same experiences. We had different socioeconomic backgrounds, but the richness of the friendship was a lifetime of endurance. So when you look around this room, you're not better than anybody in here. You're better collectively than anybody at Stanford. All right. You didn't hear me say that. All right. As you step into the legal arena, remember that you're not alone. You're part of a noble profession that has the power to change society and shape lives. Lean on your mentors, support your colleagues, collaborate with others to affect meaningful change. Seek justice, not just for your clients, but for the greater good. Strive for excellence. Work on your legal skills. Be humble and know that you don't know everything and you don't know what you don't know. But also make sure that you're moving with the character and the integrity that you would like to be met with if it were your family member who were facing some of the trials and tribulations of the people that you'll be representing. I cannot tell you how meaningful it is to stand on this stage. We've shared the same mentors. Judge Streeter and I have tried cases alongside of each other. Your dean has become like family to me, and Cara has been a mentee that the joy of seeing her transition and move through the world brings me more joy than my paycheck, because it's very modest. But I do invite you to come to the federal court, even if you choose not to practice in the federal court, come there and see what it represents. If you decide to clerk in your second year of practice, apply. If you decide that that's not something you want to do, consider the federal pro bono bar. We need you. We need experienced, bright minds who have compassion and who are ready to serve. And if you are truly ready to serve not just your state, but also your nation, please stand so that I can administer the oath. Please raise your right hand. I state your name.
I
do solemnly swear, or affirm that as an attorney, and as a counselor of this court, I will conduct myself uprightly and according to the law. And that I will support the Constitution of the United States. All those having been duly sworn, the motion is granted. Thank you.
First, I want to ask us all to thank Cara Sandberg, Justice Streeter, and Judge Thompson for their wise, their profound words. Thank you for taking time from your busy schedule to be here. Next, a huge round of applause for you on your admission to the State Bar and the Bar of the Northern District of California. An important practical detail, your state bar cards will remain here. Justice Streeter is going to sign them. He has signed each one individually, and then we will turn them all in for you. So leave your state bar cards here. And finally, there's a reception for all of you. I think it's just outside these doors. And please join us to celebrate those who've just been sworn into the bar. Thank you for coming tonight.